Hello, I'm Rick Torbett, and welcome to Better Basketball's Better One-on-One Offense, Scoring from the Perimeter, with Rick Barry, Sue Bird, and Chauncey Billings. Now, the title of this video is Better One-on-One Offense, and we're going to prepare you for one-on-one offense in real games. We're not going to focus on the style of one-on-one that only works on the driveway. When most people play one-on-one against a friend, they give their opponent time to set up, then check the ball, then spend a few seconds in triple threat, and then finally they start attacking. That just doesn't prepare you for real games. In a real game, the defense doesn't get a chance to check the ball and set up. The offense gets a max of 5 seconds to put the ball on the floor, or it's a violation. And most importantly, if you don't attack immediately, you're giving the other four defenders a chance to set up and get ready to stop your penetration. So, the best kind of one-on-one, the kind of one-on-one that will give you the best chance to score in a real game, is to attack immediately, to attack before the defense gets set. And this principle holds true whether you're attacking from triple threat or off the dribble. And so, the goal of Better One-on-One Offense is to give you the best opportunity to score by teaching you how to quickly read the defense, react immediately, and to use the most effective move possible for that situation. Now, Better One-on-One Offense is divided into 8 chapters. Chapter 1 examines the triple attack tools, laying a foundation with the triple attack position, choosing a pivot foot, the quick draw, shot fake, head and shoulder fake, and drive fake. The techniques of first step explosion in Chapter 2 will make your first 2 steps past your defender as quick as your physical abilities will allow. Chapter 3 develops the defensive reads along with the offensive reactions from a triple threat position. Chapter 4 trains you not only to handle tough defensive pressure, but also how to take advantage and make the defense pay for pressuring you. Chapter 5 examines the reads and counters available to you when you're in the mid-range, including the 1-2 pull-up jumper, the hop, and the hop back. The finishing techniques in Chapter 6 will give you moves to counter recovering defenders, help defenders, and even shot blockers. Chapter 7 will simplify the defensive reads and offensive moves when you must go one-on-one off the dribble. In Chapter 8, we look at attacking the basket from a ball screen. One-on-one can become one-on-two with the number of reads doubling as well. And finally, you'll get a chance to learn from some of the best perimeter players to ever lace them up. The theme of this video is how to attack the basket from the perimeter once you have the ball. The goal of the video is to give you a sense of freedom and confidence that you can score no matter where you receive the ball, how you receive the ball, or how the defense is playing. We're going to go way beyond just a bunch of random moves. Instead, we're going to analyze exactly what you should do based on how your defender plays you. You will learn how to read the defender and react in the most efficient and effective way possible. And in keeping with the tradition of Better Basketball, I'm going to start with the basics and move in a logical step-by-step fashion until you have the total package. If you're going to get the most out of this video, you'll need to take the information from this video and move it from your brain into your game. Now granted, you'll see some improvement just by watching this video a few times. But to acquire all the skills, you need to be aware of the typical learning progression that 99% of us have to go through in order to transfer new knowledge into a new habit. If you're aware of this progression, you'll be less likely to become discouraged when you haven't mastered everything in the first 24 hours. If you know the steps it takes, then you can hang in there until the skills are a part of your game. Here they are. The first step is acquire the knowledge. See and understand the techniques to be acquired. That's what you're doing right now by watching this video. The second phase is the mechanical phase. That's a nice way of saying that when you try a new technique, it looks awkward and you feel mechanical. So it's okay to slow down and repeat the technique or move until you can perform it properly. No one likes to look awkward and mechanical, but don't worry, it's only a step towards becoming smooth and polished. With repetition, the mechanical becomes smooth and coordinated, and you're ready for the third step, the speed phase. Here, you can begin to work on speed until you can perform the technique quickly and efficiently. It becomes a true habit, something instinctive that looks natural, and you can execute at game speed without thinking. You might think that you're done at this time, but you're not. What good is learning a move if you can't apply it at the right time and in the right situation? You must learn to read and react to your defender. The next two steps will train you to make the proper read on your defender so that you can react with the right move at the right time. The first read and react step is to get a defender to play along and give you time to think about what moves to make depending on his or her position. There are no tricks by the defender. He just picks the position and you take your time to make the proper read. It's not live and it might not even be at game speed. Once you know the proper reads, the second step is to move your reaction to game speed, even though the defense isn't yet live. Successful repetition is how you build confidence. Your parents, your coach, your trainer, or your friends can tell you to be confident. They can even demand that you be confident, but you won't be confident until you can put successful repetitions under your belt. Now you're ready for the final step, game experience. Don't be timid. You've outworked your opponent. You deserve success. Now, maybe you've never looked at learning and improving this way. Maybe you've been tossed into a league and expected to gain skills and confidence simply by game experience. Well, playing is always better than not playing, but the first steps of development have been skipped. How can you expect your house to withstand the storms if you don't first lay a solid foundation and take time to build layer upon layer of infrastructure? If you try to take a shortcut, you'll eventually meet a level that will expose your weaknesses. It may not show up until the Olympics, but trust me, if there's a weakness, your opponents will find it. So if you're going to build habits into your game, then let's build the right ones the right way. Now, in keeping with better basketball tradition, without wasting any dribbles, it's time for you to read and react. Let's get started with better one-on-one offense scoring from the perimeter. I could tell you that on the perimeter, you're going to do one of three simple things. You'll shoot if you're open, or you'll drive to the goal, or you'll drive and pull up for the jump shot. That's like saying golf is as simple as teeing off with your woods, getting on the green with your irons, and putting to finish. It's true, and it's simple, but the skills required to do those things are anything but simple. In this fundamental chapter, we're going to look at the best mechanics for making the most efficient movements while attacking from the perimeter. How to read your defender and when to use each move will follow in later chapters. But the mechanics in this chapter will apply to all situations. This is our first layer, our foundation that we'll use time and again throughout the video. If you've grown up on a basketball court, you've probably heard coach after coach talk to you about getting in triple threat. But I don't want you to think about being a threat. I want you to think attack. So we're going to call it triple attack. What is triple attack position? It's the athletic stance that all athletes take when preparing to move quickly, when they don't know which direction the game's going to take them. Just think about a linebacker getting ready for the snap, or a shortstop for the pitch, or a wrestler ready to pounce. It's knees bent, feet shoulder width apart, back straight, hips bent, and bump out. Your head, knees, and feet should be in a vertical line. You can check yourself by looking down. Your knees should cover your feet, except for your toes. Add the ball in your shot pocket with hands in shooting position, and you have a triple attack position for basketball. Why start in triple attack position? Because this stance allows you to attack with a pass, or a drive, or a shot, without any adjustments to your stance. The position affords you maximum balance and optimum explosion with your first step. We'll look at how triple attack position helps your first step in the next chapter. Now, if your feet are too wide or too close together, or your knees are too deeply bent or not enough, you'll not have the best balance or best chance to move quickly. The game is more physical today than it's ever been, and to lose this athletic position anytime or anywhere gives the defense an edge and puts you at a disadvantage. So where on the court do you get in triple attack? The where is just as important as the how and the why. Obviously, you're on the perimeter, but more importantly, you're in your scoring range. Let's define that as the distance where you can hit at least 50% if left unguarded. Think of it this way. Your scoring range is that distance from the goal that when you have the ball and you're sighting the rim to shoot, the defense moves in close enough to stop your shot. Now, if that never happens to you, then you need to become a better shooter. Smart defenders who know you can't shoot will never move in close enough for you to drive past them. Finally, how do you get into triple threat? There are only two ways. Use the hop by catching the ball with both feet in the air, or use the 1-2 where your pivot foot is already planted as you catch the ball and you square up with the other foot. Regardless of which method you use, I want you to be able to use either foot as a pivot foot. We demand that players use both hands to dribble, and we demand post players be able to pivot with either foot, so why limit yourself to a permanent pivot foot? If you're able to use either foot, you can read the situation and pivot with the foot that will work best for the move you need to use. I'll give you two examples. You're on the wing with an open stance to the passer. Regardless of which side of the floor you're on, you can do whatever the defense dictates. Let's say your man plays off. You can catch and simply pivot square up for the shot on either side of the floor. And second, let's say your defender plays tight. You can use the reverse pivot and attack in the other direction, regardless of which side of the floor you're on. If you always pivot with the same foot, two of these four options wouldn't be available to you. With that being the case, I'm going to train you throughout the video to pivot with either foot as the situation demands. When you have the choice, you can choose. But my goal is to prepare you for all situations so that you can attack with either foot from any angle, stationary or on the move, from anywhere on the floor. Is this player being guarded? Yes. Is his shot being defended? No. Most players see a defender this close and they think they need to move the defender with a fancy jab or sweep to get their shot off. But hey, he's not being pressured. He's not even being guarded if he's mastered the quick draw. A quick draw allows a shooter to go from shot pocket to release point before the defender can do anything to stop it. Let's define the quick draw read like this. If the defender's hand isn't in your shot pocket or on your shot line, then shoot. If he's close to you, but his hands are down, pull the trigger. If he's got a hand up, but he's too far away, fire. The bottom line is, if he can't touch the ball in your shot pocket or up through your shot line, quick draw. Now, let's make sure you understand when you can't quick draw. You can't quick draw when your man's all over you. You can't quick draw when the defender's got a hand in your shot pocket. Bottom line, you can't quick draw if you're not in triple attack. But to have a successful quick draw, you can't have a dip, a hitch, or a two-piece shot. This is why the type of shot that you developed from our first video, Better Shooting, is so important. You need a one-piece, efficient shot whose release is timed with your feet coming off the ground. When you decide to pull the trigger, everything goes up at once. Like a gunslinger from the Old West, the ball has left your fingers before the defense can get to it. So if the defender blocks your shot, then you may not have a one-piece shot. You may be dipping the ball, you may be hanging too long, or you simply need to speed things up. You can train yourself to read this situation, ignore the defender, and pop your shot before the defender can come out of his stance. Here's how. Set yourself in triple attack position. Let your training partner get in a stance and extend a hand on top of the ball. When the defender drops his hand, it's live. Quick draw. The defender then jumps to try and block your shot when he sees you shooting. With repetition, you'll know the defense can't do anything to stop your shot. You'll have a true quick draw, and your shooting confidence will go up. We're talking about training the mind here. Let me explain. When you watch a scary movie, you know it's not real, and there's no real reason to be scared, but you are. The mind can be fooled between what's real and not real. Train your mind to ignore this defender, because if he can't touch the ball, he's not there at all. The shot fake assumes that you can make the shot if left unguarded. Again, let's not overlook the fact that if you can't make the shot, then your shot fake will be useless. I'm not talking about believing that you can make it. I'm talking about having a reputation of hitting the open shot. Only then will you draw a defender closer to you when you fake the shot. That's why I cannot emphasize enough that you must become a good shooter. That's why Better Basketball's first video was on shooting. You can't be a single threat, a penetrator, or a double threat, a passer and a penetrator. You need to be a triple threat, someone who can shoot, pass, or drive. Now, we all know a good shot fake when we see it. A shot fake is meant to draw a defender closer in order for you to drive around him. If you shot fake too quickly, then he can't see it and react to it. So slow it down. Think slow shot fake, but quick drive. As you develop your shot fake, don't try to do too much. Less is more, and simple is best. Just take your normal shot motion and stop short before the ball gets to your nose. Don't raise up and come out of your triple attack position, or you'll lose the ability to be explosive. You might find it helpful to get in front of a mirror and see if you can sell yourself with your own shot fake. While you're there, take your shot fake to another level by giving the illusion that you're raising up with your shot. When you shot fake, lower your butt at the same time. When you rip the ball down, you'll still be in an explosive stance. Now, the shot fake should go no higher than your nose for two reasons. First, you don't want to block your vision of the goal or the rest of the players. Second, a high shot fake slows down your drive. I don't care how quick your feet are. In order to drive, you must put the ball on the ground. So you can't begin to go by the defender until the ball has moved from the top of your shot fake back down to hip level and then to the floor with your first step. A high shot fake means the ball has to travel a long way, and that takes a long time. A shorter shot fake means shorter distance and shorter time. This is called being quick with the ball, or ball quick. If you want to drive left, then fake to the right. If you want to drive right, then fake to the left. Simple enough to say, but how do you do it? Do you step to the left and then go right? Do you fake a pass to the right and then go left? These fakes take you out of triple attack stance and hurt your ability to be explosive. Instead, fake with your head and shoulders. This allows you to keep the ball near your shot pocket, stay in an explosive stance, and minimizes your foot movement, keeping you safe from a traveling call. Head and shoulder fakes are small fakes. They might only make your defender lean a little to the left, but that's enough for you to beat him right. It might only make your defender move a half step to the right, but that's enough advantage for you to beat him left. The shot fake is used to pull a defender in so that you can drive. In the same sense, but with the opposite purpose, the drive fake is used to move the defender back so that you can shoot. Now, what probably comes to mind when I say drive fake is a series of long jab steps and jab moves that start in triple threat. I can appreciate the intent, that is, to move the defender back and create space to shoot. However, there are three problems. First, if the long jab is successful, meaning the defender retreats, you have to reset your feet to shoot. This gives the defender time to recover. There's just no way to shoot when you're in this extended stance. Second, if you overextend that jab foot, you lose your chance to be explosive. In fact, that's the subject of our next chapter. Third, any kind of excess foot movement seems to elicit a traveling call from the officials. That's why I haven't mentioned faking with a jab step to the right in order to drive left or vice versa. Some players mix a short jab with the head and shoulder fake and are very effective and get away with it. But for the one player who effectively fakes with his feet, I see 10 players turning the ball over with a traveling call. Now, there are two possible reasons that foot fakes could lead to so many traveling calls. It could be the game is moving faster and quicker, which makes reading your feet more difficult for the referees. Or it could be that in the last decade, players' footwork has gone from bad to worse. Whatever the reason, I'm simply being pragmatic when it comes to faking with your feet. You're risking a traveling violation. So, with that being said, is there a dry fake or a jab that can be used, one that keeps you in an explosive stance and enables you to quick draw? You bet. If your jab goes no further than your normal shooting stance, triple attack position, then you can shoot without any adjustment to your stance. Your jab has bagged the defender off, and you can quick draw. Now, I'm not looking for you to use this move over and over to get off your shot. Hey, when you back that foot up, a good defender might eat up that space and keep you from getting back into triple threat. So don't look at this as a move from triple threat. Look at this as a way to get into triple threat when you're catching a pass in an open stance. Let's look at three examples. Waiting one pass away with your pivot foot planted toward the goal and an open stance to the passer. Perhaps you were intending to catch the ball square to the goal, but the pass is thrown behind you. You're trying to shorten your distance to the goal by dragging a foot while catching the pass. In all these cases, you have to pivot and square up as soon as you catch the ball. So why not make your pivot square up look like a drive? Jab your foot right to your shooting stance or triple attack stance. Jam the ball into your shot pocket and look like you're ready to drive. Now the ball is on your shot line and in your shot pocket. It's a simple read from there. Hands are down, quick draw. A short closeout, fire. Show retreat, swish. And if he freezes, see ya. In a nutshell, if the drive fake works, then quick draw. If it doesn't work, then nothing is lost. You don't have to make any adjustments. You're in triple attack with a good stance and good balance and the ability to explode by your man. How do you blow by him? That's chapter two. Everyone wants that explosive first step that leaves the defense holding onto their shorts. Hidden among the details of your first step and first dribble are secrets that can pack serious punch into your game. Understanding and applying even one of these techniques will give you a quicker first step. Mastering them all will allow you to maximize your physical abilities and make you the most explosive player you can be. The first step to becoming quicker is to make sure your mechanics are efficient. To do this, we must break your motion down step by step so that you can correct any wasteful movements that might slow you down. Most of this chapter is explained in terms of an open step and a cross step. Let's define them first. If you drive in the direction of your attack foot and leave your body open to the defender, it's an open step. But if your attack foot crosses your pivot foot, it's a cross step. Now, let's first examine the open step. From triple attack position, rip the ball quickly to your hip and prepare to open step. Make sure that you've rotated the ball, dribbling hand on top and your other hand underneath. The reason for moving the ball to your hip is that before you go by the defense, you want to hide and protect the ball by putting part of your body between the ball and the defender. This is called keeping your game tight. Defenders will be reaching in and hacking at the ball. You want to be strong, tight, and compact. From here, you're ready to time the first step and dribble together. This means your foot and the ball hit the ground at the same time. This ensures that the ball is being dribbled before the pivot foot leaves the ground. Put yourself in the official's shoes. Referees must make a split-second decision, and I've always believed that it's made not on what they see, but what they think they see. And when they see your first step and the ball hitting the ground at the same time, they know your pivot foot has not left the ground too early. So, time the first step and dribble together to ensure a legal move and no travel calls. Place the dribble outside of your foot for two reasons. First, you don't want to dribble off your toes. Second, with the ball on the outside of the leg, it's farther from the defender and your leg is being used for added protection. Reach out with your non-dribbling hand, your inside arm, as if you're going to shake hands with someone. I'll explain why later in this chapter. Now, let's take a look at the cross step. Again, rotate the ball on the way to the other hip so that your dribbling hand, in this case, the left hand, is on top of the ball. As your attack foot crosses over your pivot foot, again, time the ball hitting the floor with your foot hitting the ground. Reach out and shake hands with the inside arm. We'll turn this movement into one smooth motion that slices like a knife. But first, let's maximize your quickness and explosiveness by improving your biomechanics. I've spent a lot of time talking with the best speed people in the world. Speed, quickness, and explosion are not just about who has the strongest muscles. They're also about using the movements that best allow you to maximize your quickness. You must recruit the right muscles with the right movements to reach your explosion potential. Let's apply this science to your first two steps. To start, let's take a look at the open step. The leg that you're pivoting with will initiate the first explosion. This is the foot opposite the direction you want to go. Your hip, quads, and calf all come into play, but the most explosive muscles are located in your glutes. Bending your knees is not enough to recruit your glutes. Your hips must be bent as well, just like you saw in triple attack. In addition, your knee should be over the ball of your foot. And to push off at an angle, the line of your knee must be slightly on the inside of your foot. How your first step hits the ground is crucial in determining how explosive your first two steps are. Let's look at two principles. First, don't step heel to toe. If the only part of your foot to hit the ground is the ball of your foot, you'll immediately explode in your second step. Think of it like the difference between a jogger who runs heel-toe and a sprinter who stays on the balls of his feet. Second, your foot should hit the floor directly below or behind the line of your knee. In other words, your shin should be at an angle of less than 90 degrees with the floor. This, combined with your chest stuck out and your head over your knee, allows you to recruit the glutes a second time. Now, when players cross-step, they don't seem to have a problem with these mechanics. The shin strikes the ground at the correct angle, and with the head over the knee, the glutes are recruited for maximum explosion. But problems seem to occur with the open step. Many players are so eager to beat their defender with that first step that they take a really long stride to get completely by their man. And the longer the step gets, the slower the rest of the move becomes. No amount of practice will make it better. You must first understand what you're doing wrong before you can fix it. Let's look at why you slow yourself down with an extremely long open step. When you take a long first step and your foot hits the ground in front of your knee, the shin forms an angle greater than 90 degrees with the ground. Your glutes are not recruited as your heel hits the ground first. In fact, this is actually the motion you'll use to stop, not to explode by your defender. So to compensate, your hamstrings must now pull your body forward until your weight is back to being over your knee, the point where your glutes and quads can be used. Your hamstring is weak and slow, and you even stand a chance of hurting it when you ask it to pull your body forward in this manner. So, to get the most out of your open step, shorten it slightly. Strike the ground with the ball of your foot and get your head and chest over your knee with your shin angle less than 90 degrees with the ground. Now you'll recruit your glutes for maximum explosion. It's a well-known fact in track that sprinters use their arms to explode out of the blocks. In the same fashion, I want you to use your arms and the added weight of the ball to explode in your first step past the defender. When you're creating momentum, using your arms and a 1.5-pound ball can make the difference, and that's our third explosion factor. You learned in the first section of this chapter to bring the ball from your shot pocket to your hip. Then, in a separate movement, you learned to time your step and dribble together. The purpose of this section is to blend those two steps into one aggressive, momentum-gaining motion. Your feet cannot move any quicker than you can move the ball from your shot pocket or the top of your shot fake into the first dribble. To visualize this, think about painting the letter C with the ball. When you circle tight and use a violent rip into your first dribble, it will help shift your center of gravity and get you quickly into your first step. This is the very definition of being ball quick. Now, when you blend this small circle movement of the ball with a head and shoulder fake, you get the best of both worlds. A more effective fake in one direction combined with a more explosive drive in the other direction. In a similar manner, The ball can be used to gain momentum when you're sweeping the floor and using the ball to punch your way past the defender. But I'll cover this in chapter 4 when we look at how to handle extreme defensive pressure. To V or not to V? That is the question. The answer is that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. And so choosing a straight line instead of a longer curved line is the quickest way to get where you want to go. The battle between you and your defender can be looked at as this battle between the V and the U. Here's what I mean. Go by the defender, not around him. If you control the space and go by him, your lines of attack form the letter V. If you go around him, then your lines of attack form a U. The defender wants you to drive in a U. This slows you down and gives him a chance to recover and his teammates a chance to help. The V is quicker and leaves little chance for your defender to recover. Now, you must protect the ball, eat up the space between you and the defender, and stay on a V line of attack. Let's take a look at the technique. When we were learning the proper mechanics of the first step, I told you to time your dribble and step together and reach through with the inside arm as if to shake hands. Shooting the inside arm past your defender is another way to use your arms like a sprinter. It helps to shift your weight and momentum and assist the explosion. Watch it being done going right with an open step and a cross step. Now going left, open step and cross step. To control the space and stay on your V line of attack, imagine that the only door to go by your defender is here. The lock on the door is located at his hip, and the key to open it is your inside arm and shoulder. So reach through the keyhole and shake hands on the other side. Control the space as you go by. Brush his hip with your arm and shoulder to make sure you're eating up the space. Now you're guaranteed to be taking the most direct line to the basket. The emphasis in phase one is proper mechanics. Protect the ball by ripping it to your hip and eliminate the travel call by timing the dribble and the first step together. We're also going to train both feet as pivot feet with the ability to open or cross step with either foot. First, the left foot is your pivot foot. Ready? Right hip, open. Left hip, cross. Now the right foot is your pivot foot. Ready? Right hip, cross. Left hip, open. Add the shot fake. Left foot, pivot foot. Shot fake. Right hip, open. Shot fake. Left hip, cross. The emphasis in phase two is moving these pieces into one smooth motion without eliciting a traveling call from the officials. We're not looking for speed and explosion yet, just a coordinated, natural motion that keeps the ball tight and the player balanced. Left foot, pivot foot. Open. Cross. Right foot, pivot foot. Cross. Open. Now, let's add the shot fake and alternate going right and left on my command. I'm looking for a slow shot fake up, then back down to your hip and into your first dribble with one smooth motion. Take your time. Shot fake. Shot fake. It's time to pack some dynamite into your game. The emphasis in phase three is speed and explosion. I'm looking for you to circle the ball tight in the letter C and rip the ball into your first dribble. Choose either foot as a pivot foot and alternate going right, then left on my command. Go. Go. Now, let's add the shot fake to it. Remember, slow shot fake, but quick rip. Go. Go. To incorporate all the explosion techniques from this chapter, use a dummy defender and someone to shake hands behind the defender. On either side of the defender are cones to keep your lines of attack tight, to V the defender. The emphasis in phase four is to put it all together. Circle tight and use the ball for momentum. Recruit the glutes with the right mechanics and V the defender with a handshake. You can always replace the dummy defender with a chair, and you can even train by yourself by shaking hands with a second chair. Now that you've learned proper technique, let's see how you can build these habits into your game, step by step, starting from the beginning. The situation is one we're all familiar with, whether it's a neighborhood challenge somewhere on the asphalt, or you're facing a defensive all-star in the world championships in front of millions of people. You're on the perimeter, you still have your dribble, the defense has established their position, and you need to score one-on-one. Can the defender touch the ball in your shot pocket? If not, shoot. He knows you're a threat to drive, and he doesn't want to give up penetration. So he's playing off you to give himself time to react and cut off the drive. He's giving you the open shot, so take it. Remember, if he can't touch the ball, then he's not there at all. Quick draw. If the defender is too close for you to shoot, then drive. Don't shot fake. There's no need. Just drive. Now, this spacing is a judgment call that comes with experience. But let me give you a clear-cut read. If the defender dares to stick his hand in your shot pocket, then drive. Circle tight under his hand and rip to your hip, straight into your first step by him. But which way? Right or left? A common approach is to read his feet and attack the lead foot. What does that mean? If he leads with his left foot, then attack that foot by driving right. And if he leads with his right foot, then drive left. Why? Because if you drive toward his back foot, then he simply step slides with you. But if you attack the lead foot toward the direction of his heel, then your defender must swing step to recover. But the swing step is slower, giving you more time to get by him. And if you control the space by brushing his hip with your handshake, then it's even more difficult for the defender to swing step and cut you off. But let's take this read to another level, because I want your reaction to be as quick as your read. An even shorter read, without having to look down at his feet, is to read your defender's lead shoulder and attack his back. Picture it this way. There's an arrow sticking perpendicular out of your defender's back. It will point the way for you to drive. With his left foot or left shoulder leading, his back points to the right. With his right foot or right shoulder leading, his back points to the left. So what's the quickest read? Go away from your defender's face and attack the back. Okay, so if there's space to shoot, quick draw. And if his hand is in your shot pocket, drive. But what if your defender's found a middle distance that keeps you from being able to make a clear read? Your shot fake could draw him into driving range. Any movement by your defender to close the gap between you is a drive read. Go. Read his back, the lead hand, the lead foot, or whatever, but read and go. When you shot fake, your defender might not move closer, but he might race up, looking to block your shot. This is a drive read as well. When your defender is vertical, he must drop back down to an athletic stance before he can move. The time it takes for him to do this gives you the advantage you need to beat him. Raise him up and go. Let's summarize. If he can touch the ball in your shot pocket, drive. If he can't, quick draw. If you're not sure, draw him closer with a shot fake. But there's another possibility. What about the situations where your defender plays too far away for you to drive, refuses to be drawn closer with your shot fakes, and you don't want to take the shot that's being given to you? Now, why wouldn't you take the shot? Well, maybe you've caught the ball outside your shooting range, or you're having a bad shooting night. Perhaps your defender's in foul trouble, and you need to take him to the rack and draw the foul. Whatever the reason, you'll have to close the gap and attack the defender off the dribble. Attacking from the dribble is covered in Chapter 7. Before we leave the triple attack position, I have a reminder. Take what the defense gives you. Basketball is best played by instinct. It's not a game of chess where you can strategically plan out each move, so don't make up your mind about what you're going to do ahead of time. Defense can take away some things, but they can't take away everything. When the defense tries to take away one part of your game, they leave another part open. Read and react accordingly and take advantage. Now, when it comes to spacing, there's one situation that remains to be covered: extreme defensive pressure. I'm talking about no space, body to body, in your face pressure defense. How to handle it is the subject of our next chapter. Defenders like to get up in your grill for lots of reasons. One of them is to force you out of your triple attack stance so that you cannot attack the way you learned in the previous chapter. This is a good way to define defensive pressure. You're unable to get in or remain in triple attack position. Another reason defenders get up in your grill is to create turnovers. These turnovers are usually a result of the offensive player not knowing what to do with the ball or his stance when the defender plays tight. Well, this chapter will teach you how to react to the pressure and protect the ball while putting yourself in a position to attack and make the defense pay for playing you too tight. The first method for handling pressure does not incorporate a change in your stance. Many players are intimidated by a hand in the shot pocket and feel it's a reason to get out of triple attack. Don't give up the shot pocket so easily. Instead, do everything you can to remain in triple attack. When your defender sticks his hand in, circle the ball without changing your stance. You can train yourself with a partner in this way. You get in triple attack, your partner gets in a defensive stance and extends his hand to the point of being in your shot pocket, but not close enough to touch your body. Neither player can move their feet. As your partner tries to deflect the ball, circle tight and keep the ball in the area below your chin and above your knees. Second, the defender can pressure you square up, directly between you and the goal, and close enough to touch your body. You must protect the ball. There's no space to circle tight. There are two ways to attack. The first way to handle this pressure is to front pivot and go head to head with your defender. You must be as low or lower than the defense. Put the ball on the back of your free knee. This is for protection, but also for baiting the defense. If he takes the bait and slides over to play the ball, then sweep the floor below his hands and cross step by him. Get strong with the ball and rip it through. The defense has become aggressive and you can't give ground or show fear. Meet pressure with aggression. But if he doesn't take the bait and makes no adjustments to his stance, then step by him with an open step, just like you've been taught. Time your step and dribble together and reach past him with your inside arm. Maybe your defender is much quicker than you and counters every move you make like this. He pressures, you counter, he shifts. You sweep and he retreats ahead of you. Then reset to triple threat, read his recovery, and attack. Now, the sweep is a scoring move, but if your defender's ultra quick, you might not get a chance to put the ball on the floor. But that's okay. You haven't given in to his pressure. You've returned to triple attack position, the position you wanted in the first place. Some players use the sweep a lot. They'll rock the ball back and forth and mix in a few foot fakes. This is an attempt to move the defender, to make him dance, shift his feet, and change his position until an opening is created. As you become creative with this move, don't take it too far. Don't overstep so far that you lose your ability to explode. Keep your game tight. Never be far away from triple attack in case there's space to shoot. The second way to attack involves a reverse pivot. If you catch the ball in an open stance and the defense is pressuring you square up, a reverse pivot on the outside foot will create space. As you reverse pivot, sweep the floor in the space created right into an open step past your defender. Now, if the defense adjusts to your sweep, then you can re-sweep with a cross step and go by him in the other direction. And just like in the previous section, if you sweep and your defender adjusts, and you re-sweep and he gives ground, reset the triple threat, read and attack. Finally, the defender can pressure you at an angle, taking away your ability to square up. He's belly to belly with you, crowding your ability to use either of the previous moves. This time, reverse pivot on the inside foot. Not only do you relieve the pressure, but you instantly create a seal and a half-step advantage on your defender. Besides relieving pressure, the reverse pivot is meant to seal your defender behind you. When you pivot, point your foot toward the goal. This will complete your seal and give you a straight line of attack to the goal. If your foot lands at an angle, it's a sign you've not made a complete pivot or a complete seal. As a result, your first step will be shorter and the defender can recover. One dribble will get you to the hole. If your defender recovers, then reset the triple threat and quick draw. If he tries to eat up the space, consider that you're now in triple attack. Depending on his lead shoulder, attack his back as you learned in the third chapter. Regardless of whether you sweep the ball, attack from triple threat, or beat your man off the dribble, once you've taken that first dribble, there are decisions to be made in the mid-range. The mid-range is the area between your first step from your pivot and finishing at the goal. To be effective, you must continue to read your defender while reading help defenders at the same time. But we'll discuss how to score against help defenders in Chapter 6 on finishing. For now, let's dive into the hop, hop back, and pull-up jumper, your weapons in the mid-range. If you don't make it to the goal, you'll probably shoot a pull-up jumper. But before we look at the defensive reads that dictate when you should use the pull-up jumper, we need to examine its footwork. There's always been a lot of discussion about whether you should shoot from a 1-2 or a 2-foot hop. Well, that's really not the question, because there are advantages to both. So the real question is when to use each one. Let's get into it by first examining the 1-2. The primary advantage of the 1-2 is that it's the quickest way to shoot off the dribble. Starting our clock, the moment the ball hits the ground on the last dribble and ending when the ball is released, let's compare the amount of time it takes for a player to shoot from a 1-2 versus a hop. In basketball, that's a significant amount of time, enough time for a retreating defender to recover and block the shot. Now, I can't make you physically quicker, but I can teach you to be efficient, which will make shooting the 1-2 even quicker. When you shoot off the dribble going to your strong hand, don't catch the ball off the dribble and then set it and then shoot. That's too slow. Instead, push the dribble down a little harder than normal and ride it up with your shooting hand. Your offhand simply moves to the side of the ball and assists the upward motion of the shot. To stop your forward motion and go up straight, the foot opposite the dribble hand must put on the brakes. The foot strikes the ground heel first in front of your head and your knee. The angle of your shin with the ground is greater than 90 degrees when the foot strikes the ground. Notice the angles are the opposite of the techniques to explode from Chapter 2. Now, if you're at an angle to the goal, then point the toe of that foot toward the goal. Your heel puts on the brakes, your toe points the way to the goal. But when you put the dribble down with your non-shooting hand, use that hand as a pick-up and move-over hand. Watch as the ball is pushed down. The offhand rides it up, rotates to the side, and moves the ball to the shot pocket. You can get in a lot of reps without taking a shot to increase your ball quickness. And one more thing to consider, for those of you who have already mastered the basics of the 1-2. If you start in triple threat and take one dribble before you use the 1-2 pull-up jumper, your quickness and the space you cover will be dependent on whether you use an open step or a cross step. First, let's watch an open step. He takes 3 steps and therefore covers a lot of ground. Now let's watch a player take a cross step. He needs just 2 steps and therefore covers half the ground, but the shot gets off quicker. That's why using a cross step on a 1 dribble pull up is quicker. There's only 2 steps. Now for the defensive read. Generally speaking, those players who seem to take the most advantage of the 1-2 are the great penetrators. Any movement toward the goal by a great penetrator forces their defender to aggressively retreat to the goal. And that's going to be your defensive read for shooting the 1-2 pull-up. During your first dribble of penetration, look for an aggressive retreat by your defender. He might still be beside you or already be ahead of you, but either way, he's turned to sprint and is out of his defensive stance. The 1-2 allows a shot to be on its way before the defender can change direction and contest your shot. Compare shooting with a 2-foot jump stop in this situation. An extra hop would allow the defender time to recover and block the shot. Before we examine the advantages for shooting with a hop in the mid-range, let's look at how to develop the footwork and defensive reads step by step. As always, we'll start with the basics as if you've never shot a 2-foot hop. And within a few minutes, we'll progress to the top level. Now, to understand the following defensive reads, you must first understand what I mean by beating your defender clean. If you beat your defender clean, then he's behind you, on your back, and all that's left is to finish your drive, depending on help defense. But this section of the video deals with what to do if you've not beaten your defender clean. That is, he's still on your side with a chance to block or change your shot. Now, how did this happen? Well, maybe your threat to penetrate was not enough to make him retreat aggressively and allow you to shoot the 1-2. Or maybe your defender overplays you to one side. In other words, he doesn't play you square, but forces you in one direction. Regardless of how it happens, you've not beaten your defender clean. Now, let's begin to build it step by step and develop your footwork, reads, and eventually your 2-foot hop. Make your first step directly to the goal. Remember the straight lines of the V in Chapter 1. After the first dribble, create separation from the defender by pushing off with your inside foot. At this stage, just step to the side. Push away from your defender off the inside foot. If there's enough space, then shoot. But if the defender tries to recover, keep your dribble alive and read the angle. If he recovers straight towards you, along the line of your sidestep, then drive in the open space. If he recovers to cut off your line to the basket, cross over and take him in the other direction. To develop the hop back, start out by using a simple step back at a 45 degree angle. Once your steps are coordinated and you're ready to cover more ground, get air under both of your feet and the step back develops into a hop back. But I don't want you to think, based on these steps of development, that the hop is always at a 45 degree angle. The hop might be at any angle, as you'll see in a moment. So, let's take a more detailed look at the hop's footwork, starting in triple threat. The foot that was used to put on the brakes when you use the 1-2 is the same foot that initiates the hop. It's the inside foot, the one closest to the defender. An open step from triple threat with one dribble means 2 steps, get both feet in the air, and land on 2. A cross step from triple threat with one dribble means 1 step, get in the air, and land on 2 feet. The time you spend in the air is used to prepare your shot. While in the air, get square to the goal and chamber the ball into your shot pocket. When both feet hit the ground, it's up and out with your shot. Now, that's how to shoot in a 2-foot hop. But remember, the reason to use it is entirely different than the 1-2. After you've penetrated into the mid-range, whether from triple threat or off the dribble, the defender hasn't turned to retreat and is still close enough to bother your shot. The hop is used to create space away from this tight defender in order to get off your shot. Compare this cross-step 1-2 with the same move and an added hop. Look at how much more space is covered. The hop not only covers more ground, but allows you to change direction and land wherever you want. For a top-notch perimeter player on the three-point line, the hop back allows you to drive into two-point land, but hop back outside the arc for the three. This is more easily done with a cross step and is another reason to be able to use either foot as a pivot. Develop these two weapons, each for their own purpose. The 1-2 for the quickest shot off the dribble, and the hop to create separation from defenders. But before we leave this chapter, let's return to the case where you've not beaten your defender clean. There's another tactic to consider. Instead of hopping back to create space, lean in on the defender as you drive to the goal. Several good things can happen. As long as you don't push off with your inside arm, 99% of the time, the foul will be called against the defense. As you lean in, your defender may give in to your pressure instead of running the risk of a foul. If so, you've now beaten him clean and cut off his line of retreat. If he rides you all the way to the basket, then you'll have to finish with a defender on you. But that's the topic of our next chapter, finishing. Once you've driven past the mid-range, you'll be finishing at the goal. And you'll have to deal with your own defender who's still on your side or has managed to cut you off. But you'll also be reading and reacting to help defenders. Now, every time you get to the basket, things are slightly different based on your angle, spacing, number of defenders, all kinds of factors. So we can't cover every possible combination. But what I can do is train you to read and react to the four primary finishing situations. I say train you because you can practice the moves used in these situations. And if you can practice it, you can master it. Now, the moves required to handle these situations do require a certain amount of strength, body control, and athleticism. So be patient with yourself and keep after it until you master them. When you penetrate, the ideal result is that you beat your man clean. That is, he's behind you. Compare that to having only a half step on your defender. At the same time, you read that you can beat any help defender to the goal. This is the simplest of the five situations, and your main concern is to get the ball to the rim or in the white square as quickly as possible. The issue here is not power and going up strong, because there's nobody you need to go strong against. There's no physical contact. I don't even care which foot you jump off of or which hand you shoot with. I just want you to get there fast. Speed is everything, so don't slow down and go off 2 feet. You'll give defenders time to block your shot. But if you don't beat your man clean and he's still on your side, his only chance to stop your layup or dunk may be to strip the ball on your way up. Many players make it easy for the defender to strip the ball by swinging the ball hip to hip on their way up. You must not only break this habit, but to avoid the strip, you can't even bring the ball up through your shot pocket. So to avoid the strip, use one of the following techniques. Hide the ball from the defender. Keep it on your outside hip, far away from him, and let your body protect the ball. Shoot with the outside hand. Turn your back to the defender so that your body is between him and the goal. Lay the ball up with your outside hand. He can only strip the ball when you pick it up with two hands. So give him the inside arm to foul you, and never touch the ball with your inside hand. dribble, pick up, and shoot entirely with your outside hand. As you saw in the previous chapter, if you lean into the defender, he may give up the space in order to avoid the foul. He can't strip you if he's behind you. The third situation involves a help defender who's waiting on you, intending to take the charge. The defender's distance from the goal will determine your move. First, let's look at help defense near the goal, inside the lane. You must change the line of your drive and show the official that you're avoiding the charge. If you go off 1 foot, you can change the position of your body somewhat and give the illusion that you're avoiding him. But going off 2 feet allows you to truly shift your body and change the line of your drive. Here's how. While going into the hop, you'll be deciding which way to shift. The first foot to hit the ground should be opposite the direction you want to go. If you're going to shift to the right, land on your left foot first and shift your weight over your right foot. Your momentum is going to carry you by the defender. Extend and reach for the goal. Depending on your size, length, and athletic ability, you might finish the move with a finger roll, a teardropper, or recompose and shoot with two hands. But what if the charge taker arrives early and outside the lane? You can still get to the goal by hopping around the defender. You need to protect the ball, change direction to avoid the charge, and cover enough ground to get to the rim. Let's break it down. Snatch up your dribble and leave the ground off 1 foot. To avoid contact, change the angle of your drive with a long hop. Turn your back to the defender while in the air. This protects the ball with your body. Whenever you place your body between the defender and the ball, you're practicing a good fundamental. Now, land on 2 feet and extend to the goal. In this section, let's look at 3 different situations in which you're going to encounter a shot blocker. First, he arrives late from behind you. Second, he arrives at the same time at an angle. And third, he arrives early and is facing you. If the shot blocker is late and is coming from behind you, there's 2 ways to avoid the block. If you're driving from the wing or baseline, your best move might be to let your momentum carry you to the other side of the goal and use the rim for protection. Once he's committed to blocking you on one side of the goal, he can't change to the other side in midair. But if you're driving from the top, it will be tough for you to change sides of the goal. Instead, create so much space between the ball and the shot blocker that he can't get the block. This can be done by angling your body, jumping horizontally, and extending the ball in front of you. If the shot blocker arrives at the same time but not positioned on your line to the basket, then his angle is going to allow you a chance at a 3-point play. Don't try to avoid contact and lean away from the shot blocker. This gives him a better chance of blocking your shot, and you have less of a chance of scoring or drawing the foul. So here's how to finish and get the 3-point play. When the shot blocker jumps, you must also leave the ground and draw contact while you're both in the air. Plant your inside shoulder squarely in his chest. At the point of contact, the line of your shoulder should form the letter T with his shoulders. Don't open up. That would let him in to block your shot. With contact on your inside shoulder, you must shoot with your free hand, your non-contact arm. Most importantly, do not continue your drive straight to the goal because his contact will knock you off of the line of the drive. Instead, shift your momentum and jump into the shot blocker. This allows his force to straighten you up and keep you balanced and knocks you back on your line to the basket. But in extreme cases, the shot blocker's reach will allow him to block your shot whether you draw contact or not. In other words, you're going against a great shot blocker and you're just not going to get the shot off. So if you're not going to get the bucket, at least draw contact, get the foul, and get your points at the free throw line. If the shot blocker is in position, facing you on the line of your drive, jumping into the defender is going to result in an offensive foul. So what's your strategy now? I'll give you two options. Create more space away from him with the side hop. This is done by pushing off with the inside foot and landing on 2 feet at a good angle for the bank shot. If you're driving the right side, then push off with the left foot. If you're driving the left side, then push off with the right foot. The angle of your drive or the available space might not allow you to hop away. Then the teardrop or floater is the option to choose. This takes practice, ball control, and good shooting touch, but it's worth working on. Your dribble penetration takes you into the lane, but you cannot make it to the goal. After you pick up the ball, the help defense closes the gap. What do you do? I'll give you two moves that will still allow you to finish closer to the goal. Shot fake, and if he leaves the ground, up and under. Here's how. Shot fake above your head, like a post player. Take the ball ear to ear, pass your hips by stepping through, and jump towards the goal. If you shot fake and he doesn't leave the ground but remains body to body, reverse pivot, spin and seal while you jump towards the goal. I'll give you one more option. Pass. Some players feel that just because they've beaten their man and gotten near the lane, they have to finish. But if you've beaten your man and drawn help, somebody's open. Don't think you have to finish. Be a complete player and consider passing. Who do you pass to? What do I mean by dribble attack? Let me first tell you what it doesn't mean. I don't mean for you to catch the ball on the perimeter, immediately waste your dribble, back up and begin to attack. That simply says that you don't know how to attack from triple threat. I'm also not talking about standing on the perimeter and dribbling 17 times without going anywhere. In a real game, you only have 4 seconds because the 5th second's a violation and the other team's ball. Dancing in one place while you show the defense every weapon in your arsenal is not smart. Plus, dribbling in place gives the other 4 defenders time to get into their defensive help positions. Now, if you do manage to get by your man, the odds are that help defense is going to be there to stop you. And let's face it, if a player can stand in one place and shine his or her shoes with 7 or 8 dribbles, it's because the defense is backed off, giving her plenty of space and begging her to shoot the ball. And obviously, she can't shoot. Only a fool would step up and give her a chance to drive. The best thing for this player to do is get a jump shot and work on her shooting range. So here's what I do mean by dribble attack, and this chapter is divided accordingly. You have the ball outside of your shooting range, and you must close the gap to your defender off the dribble. Or you've used your dribble to come off a ball screen or to look for a good passing angle, but nothing develops, and now you need to attack. I'm not going to log for you all the types of dribbles that you can use at the point of attack. Those can be found on our ball handling video. There's more than enough. The stutter step, hesitation, crossover, between the legs, around the back, spin. There's the straight line moves, the in and out, fake crossover, one hand mini cross, cross recross, and more. These alone give you 10 possible moves. Now, there's no doubt that a good combination can create space to shake your defender. And so, if you put 2 of those 10 dribbles together in a combination, in any order, then you have 100 possible combinations. I think that's more than enough to satisfy anyone's desire for creativity. My concern is not which combination becomes your signature move off the dribble. My concern and the goal of this chapter is to teach when, where, and how to use these moves when attacking the perimeter. The first category is when you have space to face. You have the ball outside of your shooting range, perhaps even outside of what's considered the perimeter, and you must close the gap to your defender off the dribble. As you approach your shooting range, use a body fake about one body length from your defender. You might use the shake and bake, stutter step, or hesitation to read your defender. Using one of these moves has the same purpose as a shot fake or a drive fake when you're in triple threat. If your defender backs up, then pull the trigger, quick draw. The same read as in triple threat. If his hands are down and there's space to chamber the ball in your shot pocket, then fire. It's that simple. If the defender freezes or comes out of his defensive stance, then you have the momentum advantage. Read his back and blow by him. As you make your body fake move, some defenders will force you to change direction by moving to the ball side. They'll move their head to the ball to take away the body fake straight line move. Starting your move one body length from your defender will give you enough space to beat him with a simple crossover. But now you meet the savvy, experienced defender. He's forced you to change direction with a crossover or between the legs and anticipated your move. Then counter in the other direction with a recross or between the legs dribble. In fact, some players slow the first move down a little to let the defender see it and react to it, knowing all the while that they're going to quickly counter in the other direction. This is just like slowing your shot fake when you're in triple threat. Let him see it, let him react, and then attack. We've looked at freezing the defender, making him retreat, and moving him side to side. But you can also make some defenders lunge toward you. The dribbles that are usually used to do this involve some form of pulling back to give the impression that you're giving up space. You bait the defender to eat up the space, to come forward. The safest way to do this would be a simple pullback dribble. You could also use a between the legs or even a between the legs with one hand to draw the defender to you. Then attack with a simple open step, a crossover, or behind the back. The list of combinations could go on and on. Why do some combinations work and others don't? When is enough enough? And why do some particular combinations work for some players but not for others? Let's look at one example. On the first level, let's pretend that you beat your defender with a simple change of direction and change of speed by going between your legs. Level two occurs when your defender begins to anticipate this move. As a counter, you go between your legs to move the defender and back between your legs to go the other way. Now your defender's anticipation takes you to the third level. To counter his defense of your first two change-ups, you must go between your legs and back and then add a crossover. Now, notice the progression. It starts with one simple move between your legs. Only when he stops you do you come up with a counter until it finally becomes a fake within a fake within a fake. Experiment with as many as you want, but find one or two that really moves your defender. Don't take your eyes off the goal of a combination. Get him off balance, out of position, and then take advantage in the other direction. My suggestion is to keep your combination simple to reduce your chances of a turnover. Simple usually means quick, and simple and quick means help defense has less time to adjust. The second category is when the defender is on and you have no chance to face up. The defender's pressure forces you into a power dribble. This might occur when you've taken a dribble in order to get a good passing angle. It disappeared, and now you need to attack your defender. Now, when you're in a power dribble stance, the defender's pressure is keeping you from squaring up and attacking. but he's not close enough for you to seal him with a spin and go by him. What do? Penetrate with a power dribble, then quickly reverse dribble to create space between you and the defender. You're back in an attacking stance, but he's closing out, so you have the advantage. Here are the reads. If the defender stays, then quick draw. If the defender closes the space, but his lead foot is on the side of the ball, then drive with the open step. Just like triple threat, push the ball out there and shoot your inside arm past him. But if the other foot is up and there's space, then cross over. If there's not enough space for the crossover, go between the legs and drive. If he closes the gap body to body, then just like in chapter 4, spin, seal him behind you, and attack. Don't forget that combinations can be used here as well. Keep your head up. Once you get a half step on your defender, usually shoulder to shoulder, you have other reads to consider. Where are the help defenders? Where's my open space to finish? How quickly is my defender going to recover, or have I beat him clean? Remember the reads from chapter 5 in the mid-range, or moves to finish from chapter 6. At this point, the content from all the chapters should be dovetailing together. And one more thing. The purpose of these moves is to make a play that leads to points on the board. I was told 35 years ago by my coach that if you don't score, your moves are for nothing. And that's still true today. Basketball is not an extreme sport. You don't get points for drawing oohs and ahs from the crowd. Paint your game with style if you must, but sign your name with points. In the game of basketball, an offensive player standing still has a right to his position. Although a little contact is allowed, a defensive player cannot push, shove, or knock this player out of his or her established position. Instead, the defender has to go all the way around him. After the game was invented, it didn't take long for players to realize that by running their defender into a teammate with an established position, they could create an open lane to the basket or some extra space to work with. That was the thinking behind the original screen, and it still is today. And of course, you can use screens whether you have the ball or not. But since this video is about playing with the ball in your hands, we're only going to look at screens that involve the ball. And that's why we call it the ball screen, otherwise known as the pick and roll. Consider that you can take advantage of the ball screen from triple threat or off the dribble, just like the one-on-one attacks you've seen in the previous chapters. But now, attacking the goal is more complex because you have the help of a screen, two defenders to read, and a teammate that you can pass to. The key to scoring with a ball screen is your ability to read the adjustments made by the defense and then react with the appropriate move. Whether off the dribble or from triple threat, the reads and reactions will be the same. But before we examine your options, we must first lay a foundation of principles, techniques you must use regardless of how the defense plays you. It is your responsibility as the ball handler to first set your defender up to be screened and then to control the space between yourself and the screen. This can best be illustrated when the screener is facing the sideline. Imagine a line parallel to the free throw line and perpendicular with the shoulders of the screener. This should form a giant letter T. When attacking off the dribble, you can set your defender up best by taking your defender below the line of the screen, that is, below the T. Now it's easier to control the space and hang your defender on the screen. A common mistake for ball handlers is to make the cut at an angle above the line of the screen. This gives your defender a chance to fight over the top and escape contact with the screen. It might even tempt your screener to help close the gap, but movement by your screener will result in an offensive foul most of the time. As you can see in the following clips, this principle works regardless of where on the court or at what angle your teammate sets the screen. Picture the T formed by the line of the shoulders and force your defender below that line. But if you're not attacking the screen off the dribble, then don't come out of an aggressive triple attack position. Don't look at the screen and give away your intentions. Keep your defender's attention on you by faking away from the screen with a little jab or head and shoulder fake. Show that you're a threat to drive. If your defender's busy guarding you, he's easier to screen. And even when the screen arrives, continue to read your defender. Good defenders will anticipate the screen and make early adjustments with their stance or position. If they move off your line of the go, you must be ready to make them pay. Brush your teammate as you go by. Some say go shoulder to shoulder, but I want you to go shoulder to hip to keep you low and explosive. Close the gap between you and the screen and don't let your defender squeeze through over the top. Again, it's your responsibility to control the space between yourself and the screen. Have a scoring mentality. Assume that the screen works and you're going to beat both defenders to the goal. Even if you're intent on passing to your screener, the best way to draw defense and open up passing lanes is to be a scoring threat. If you've applied these principles, then your man gets picked and you're free to score. So, the defense must adjust, and they will adjust. That's the sign of a good screen, to make the defense alter their positions. So now, take your mental game to the next level and read and react to each adjustment the defense can make. If your defender slides under the screen, shoot. By sliding behind the screen, his intention is to stop your drive to the goal. He's not worried about your shot. In fact, many coaches teach their defenders to fight under the screen because most players can't hit the pull-up jumper behind the screen. Here's another reason to become a great shooter. Make them pay for going behind the screen. After you hit a few, defenders will try to fight over top and you'll have no problem running them into the screen. If the defense doesn't want to switch, then the defender of the screen will pull a show and recover move called hedging. The hedge has two purposes. First, it buys time for your defender to recover by forcing you to dribble in a wider arc than usual. And second, it prevents you from turning the corner and getting to the basket. So that's the read. How do you react? Don't let the hedge slow you down and don't pick up your dribble. Instead, create separation by going at least two dribbles past the screen. Opportunities will occur when each defender tries to recover to his original man. Either you'll have space to shoot, or you'll have a chance to hit your rolling teammate. If the screen defender hedges too far from the screen, and your defender is a bit slow getting around the screen, you'll see space between the hedge and the screen. Push the ball through and split the defenders. If both defenders double team you, then you must hit your teammate before the defense tightens the trap. This situation is covered in depth on our passing video. Get up and over with both hands, or pivot and wrap around with a bounce pass. Whichever you do, don't let the double team scare you into picking up your dribble too early. Keep your dribble alive until you can hit your open teammate. If there's a switch, then your options multiply. Let's look at the possibilities. If the defenders are content to simply switch and your teammate gets a good seal, then wrap your bounce pass around your defender for the score. If the switch forces a mismatch for your teammate, then get him the ball in the post area where he can take advantage. If the defender of the screen overplays you with a jump switch, pass in the gap. Be ready to use your dribble attack on a switching defender. Your screener might be prevented from rolling or flaring. Consider a pullback move of some kind to draw the defender to you. It's a good fade because it looks like you're giving up. When he moves towards you, go by him. Just think of all the moves and combinations from the previous chapter. There's no screen that's successful 100% of the time. So be prepared to attack again if the defense plays the ball screen perfectly. Power dribble back, switch hands as you face the other way, and use the re-screen to attack in the opposite direction.
Per Myers, ultimi 6 secondi dell'azione. Myers prova a costruirsi un tiro, va col tiro da 3.
I'm sure you've noticed that the screener has a lot of scoring opportunities. In fact, one of the best ways to get open is to set a screen. To be successful at this, the screener must know how to set the screen, at what angle to set it, where the help defense is located, and know how to read the ball handler and the two defenders. The screener must know whether to slip. Roll. Flare. Or re-screen. But these are perimeter skills without the ball, and they're covered in our next video on playing without the ball. It's a natural complement and goes hand in hand with the video you're watching. Now, why should you consider playing without the ball? Because only one player out of five can have the ball at any given time. If everyone shares the ball equally, then you're going to spend 80% of your time without the ball. What are you going to do with all that time? Are you going to stand and watch like a spectator? Or are you going to move with intelligence and increase your chance to score? Find out and complete your perimeter skills with our next video on playing without the ball. Check for it at betterbasketball.com. Now that you're ready to take on the world one-on-one, let's take a look at the big picture. You'll make these moves with every intention to score. But you don't have to score to make a play. Your move to score will draw defensive help and allow you to pass to an open teammate who actually does the scoring. That's the difference between being called a great scorer and a great player. Great players score, but do all great scorers make great plays? So, set your mind on attacking, because a legitimate, honest move to score is the best way to draw defensive help and get your teammates open. Either you score, or you set up your teammates to score. Now you're on the road to becoming a complete player and helping your team to play better basketball. Good luck.